morning, everybody. It's a great pleasure to welcome Professor Hendrik Blum from the Quantum Technology Group at the Aachen University in Germany. So Professor Blum is an expert in semiconductor qubits and kindly accepted our invitation to tell us about what's happening in this front. So thank you very much, Hendrik.
All right, yeah, well, thanks for the invitation to be here. So it's my first time in Lisbon. I already had the chance to walk around last night, see the castle. So I like the first part. If you now ask lots of questions and make the presentation fun, I also enjoy the second part. So anyway, please feel free to interrupt. Always hard to gauge the level, and anything is unclear, feel free to ask, speak up. In fact, that encourage you to. So yeah, what I'd like to focus on today are semiconductor spin qubits as one approach to quantum computing. Try to start from the development which started around 10 years ago when these devices first showed qubit-like behavior to the state of the art and give an overview of where the field is today. So I've been told you know all about quantum computing and why it's cool and what we can do with it, so I'll skip that. Maybe just mention that my view, prime factorization and decryption is one of the less interesting applications, I think. Doing quantum simulation, quantum chemistry, perhaps for catalyst design or CO2 capture someday down the road feel much more exciting, bigger impact to me. And the solid state physicists also like the vision of doing or simulating quantum materials in a much more advanced way than what is possible today. But anyway, so since I've been told you're familiar with that, let's just jump right into qubits that are needed to realize this vision and actually build quantum. I think you've already seen a colloquium on superconducting qubits by John Martinez. I think this device here is from his group. I'd say superconducting qubits, at least in a solid state realm, are the, certainly currently the leading type of implementation of qubits. There's trapped ions, and I think you've heard a talk on ion metrology, so maybe that was less on qubits, but the same techniques can also be used to realize qubits for quantum computing. What I would like to talk about today is a different approach, semiconductor spin qubits based, well, on using the spins in semiconductor structures. So why could one think these make good qubits? What are their advantages, disadvantages? First of all, a qubit is a two-level system, quantum mechanical two-level system. So you might think that any spin 1/2 particle that naturally comes with two states, a spin up or spin down, makes a good qubit. Maybe that's an obvious thing. Then, of course, a big advantage that, well, we always like to use to sell our work, but actually in some way still needs to come to life, is that qubits are compatible with semiconductor technology. So once you really want to scale up and build devices with millions of qubits, it sounds like it would certainly be useful to build on the technology that is used to build our current processors. Then another more physics-oriented advantage is that spins are, at least in some cases, very weakly coupled to other degrees of freedom, such as photons, other spins, electrical fields, so that one can achieve fairly long coherence times in these devices. For a long time, this was actually also somewhat, well, an empty promise, but one that wasn't quite initially confirmed experimentally, but by now there are qubits in using silicon, or spins in silicon, that really demonstrate extraordinarily long coherence times. What I'd like to focus on today, because still the field of spin qubits is relatively broad, are spin qubits and quantum dots. And I'd like to cover both devices in gallium arsenide and silicon, which are not the only materials one can use, but I would say they are pretty representative and represent the mainstream. Gallium arsenide has been used to pioneer the field, to do a lot of proof of principle demonstrations. And I would say it's still in the race, but recently silicon has caught up. And, well, the differences between these two materials is that, gallium arsenide rests and can rely on a lot of results from quantum transport experiments, for example, quantum Hall effect physics, so one has a lot of control over the devices. A lot of the basic physics was explored in that material. So it's a fairly mature material system as far as controlling individual electrons and spins is concerned. And it still has very favorable electronic properties. So for example, there's a single conduction band body. So basically there's only one type of wave function of electrons that are captured in the material. the effective mass is very small. It's about a 1/16 of the free electron mass, and that means that the electrons are relatively big, and one can build relatively large devices. And it also has a direct band gap, which makes it suitable for optical applications. But there's one big problem, and that is, and I'll talk a fair bit about that, there's nuclear spins in gallium arsenide. You cannot get rid of them, and that is, well, depending on your point of view, a major hurdle for building good qubits. I think it's still possible, but it's also a nice playground for doing good physics. Okay. Alright, so because of these disadvantages of gallium arsenide, people have pursued silicon as an alternative. And the nice thing is that all we've learned from gallium arsenide, and that I will mostly talk about initially, also applies as far as the physics is concerned to silicon qubits, except that certain performance metrics, like the coherence times, are much better. Now, quantum dots, and I'll say more about how these exactly look. One type of system. Another fairly common system are spins bound to donors or to various impurities. So one example that actually works very similarly and I'll touch upon are individual phosphorus donors in silicon that can also capture electrons and their spin can be used as a qubit, just pretty much in the same way as in more artificially formed quantum dots. Here you see an older example where people have measured the transport of individual electrons from a lead to donors to another lead. And then yet another system are other defects in semiconductors. A very prominent example are, for example, the NV centers. These consist of a nitrogen atom combined with a vacancy, that's NV, and feature, well, pretty nice coherence times of the millisecond range at room temperature, which is pretty unthinkable in many other systems. But this is one thing I'd like to not talk much about, just to keep some focus. But I think at the end of November, you'll have another talk that talks about NV centers from a slightly different perspective. So this is what I'd like to cover today, depending on how many questions you ask. But I'd first like to say a little bit more about the devices, how they are realized experimentally, how they are operated, then discuss how individual spins can be read out and controlled, the basic requirements for the qubits, then come to a different flavor of qubit that I have worked on about myself, namely two electron spin qubits. Here we use two spins to encode a single qubit. Discuss again readout, where particular single shot readout, which is quite representative for the technological state of the art for the system. Talk about decoherence, giving a general introduction, and then particular focusing on that resulting from the hyperfine interaction with nuclear spins and coherence of the exchange operation, which is due to electrical noise, two qubit operations, and in a sense, in the end, briefly touch on scalability concept. I think most of that will be in the afternoon. So when we start fabricating a device for quantum dots, we start with the two-dimensional electron gas in a heterostructure. So what this is essentially a semiconductor wafer, either based on gallium arsenide, but as I mentioned, this can also be done in very similar ways in silicon or silicon germanium. The key part here is that the material changes from different combinations about 100 nanometers below the surface. And when going, for example, from gallium arsenide to aluminum gallium arsenide, the band energy changes, which means it's energetically more favorable for electrons to be in this part than it is over here. But then if you dope the aluminum gallium arsenide by adding, for example, silicon atoms, the charges that are provided by these dopants prefer to sit at this interface. So they go outside the gallium algas into the gallium arsenide because they have lower energy there. But then the electric field from the dopant pulls them to the interface. If you look at the potential of these structures along the z-direction, you find, well, the interface here is offset due to the different band gap. Then a quantum well that comes from the electric field from the dopants that sit here, these are ionized, and thus the electrons are pulled towards this interface and form individual wave functions, so basically only occupy the lowest subband at this interface here. And this means that only by design of the structure, the dynamics and motion of electrons is confined to this plane here, whereas all the dynamics in this direction is, if they are designed right, completely frozen out. That's why they're called two-dimensional electron gases. Maybe a few words about these structures. these interfaces are essentially atomically smooth, they go on layer by layer, and the material here is among the highest purity, similar to silicon wafers that can be reached in the ground. It's so low, so high that it's nearly impossible to analyze what the impurities are with direct methods on a range of 10 to minus 8. Then once we have a structure like that, we put metallic gates on top. This is done using standard lithography techniques, using electron beam writing and photoresist, similar to, well, in principle, these semiconductor circuits are made. So we pattern these metallic gates, which are shown in light gray here. For scale, this could be about a few hundred nanometers, say 500 nanometers across. And if we now apply negative gate voltage to these metal structures, like shown here between this metal and the two-dimensional electron gas, that repels the electrons. So if we apply large enough voltage, the electrons underneath here are completely gone. And then, well, you see this pattern shape here. You see some two openings in the gates. Here, it will be slightly more favorable for electrons to sit. And if you tune the gate voltages exactly right, we can capture individual electrons, one or two, or pretty much any number we like, in these quantum dots. Again, the band structure that we've discussed before. So what is added to that now, and that's pretty much what you can think of from now on, is a lateral confining potential that reduces this two-dimensional electron gas to individual electrons that sit in this double well type potential. So, maybe a few words about how we can actually find out that we have individual electrons and count them. So here again is the device, now seen from the top, and the gate voltages indicated here that we apply between the two-dimensional electron gas and these electrodes. Then next to it is a so-called quantum point contact. It's essentially a small channel whose conductance depends on the occupancy with electrons of these dots. So if there's more electrons in here, electrons that want to flow through here feel a more negative potential, makes it harder for them to flow through this contact, and therefore the conductance of this contact is reduced, and that conductance can be measured with standard electrical measurements. So we have a readout signal here that changes whenever electrons are added or removed from the dot. So what we can do then is to change these voltages on the gates, and once they become more negative, at some point it will be more favorable for an electron on the dot to hop out and leave the dot. Whenever that happens, we see, as I say, a change here, and that's what's seen on this map. So you see here the conductance of our sensor on the false color scale, and these transitions here between different colors, different conductance levels, represent electrons jumping in and out of the dot. If we were to go further down this way, we wouldn't see any additional electrons, which tells us that the structure is completely empty. So here we say there's no electrons on the left, nor on the right. And then going from here to the right, we can add one electron one by one and basically count how many are there. And if we want to work with two electrons, which is, for example, done for the two electron spin qubits, or also if you wanted to work with two individual spins, each being one qubit, you would then zoom into the structure and work in the vicinity of the transition where, for example, either two electrons are separated or they are combined in the 0-2 configuration both in one dot. And then we can also use this charge sensor again to distinguish these two configurations. And here you see that there's a different contrast or different signal level on the left and right. This can be used to read out the qubit. A few words about how these devices are operated. We work in dilution refrigerators, which, well, depending on the concept, either run on liquid helium or electricity, or they always need electricity. First cool down to 4 Kelvin, liquid helium temperature, and then use the same thermodynamics that works in your kitchen fridge, but with a different medium, using helium-3, helium-4 mixture to cool the experiments down to tens of millikelvin. The samples are then placed in a magnetic field in a cold finger at the bottom of this cryostat and specifically placed on high-frequency circuit boards. So I was recently shown this picture, which is actually pretty similar to what we use today in our experiments, and that's good enough to a PhD school, and experimentalists from your arm audience found that was a little bit old-fashioned and looked low-tech. So the spin qubit community is thinking about fancier boards like this one with more wires, more connectors, more chip-on-chip components. But for the moment, what is currently done these slightly older style circuit boards are actually good enough. And that's maybe take-home message that spin qubits in some ways are a little bit less engineering intensive than many of the superconducting qubits because we need less high frequencies, at least in some flavors. And I think when it comes to scaling up, that could be an advantage. Alright, so I think you've been familiar with the what is needed to make a qubit. We first need to realize it, what's known as the Divergenza criteria. So I've shown you how we do this at a high level, and then the rest is basically about control of the qubit, putting it into a state, reading out the state, and controlling the qubit, and how this is done on semiconductor qubits is what I'd like to focus on for the rest of the presentation. So I'd like to start with single spins because it's conceptually simple. Simplest, how they can be initialized and read out, and then how they can be controlled, first using ESR with AC magnetic fields, and then how similar principles can be used for electrical control, and then come to different types of devices. So this was one seminal experiment, as I said, about 10 years ago, that was in a series that marked the birth of spin qubits, namely the demonstration that it is possible to read the state of the signal of the single spin of an electron trapped into a quantum dot. So this is again a quantum dot like we've discussed, except there's only now a single one. You're going to have a charge sensor here, and the electron can tunnel in and out of the dot to a reservoir. This is just a Fermi seed, so a reservoir of electrons, and one of these gates can be used to apply fairly large pulses to raise and lower the potential. So let's assume we have applied a sufficiently negative voltage here. That means that all the electrons are pushed out, and correspondingly, the currents with the charge sensor here, shown here, will correspond to a level with no electrons present, so say there's no current. And if you look at the levels of the spin here, they're always split by the Zeeman splitting, so the spin up and spin down have different energy due to the applied field. That's represented by these two levels, but they're all above the Fermi level in the lead, shown on the left here. That's where they're going to be. Now, the next step is to change the voltage here, make it less negative, pull these levels below the Fermi energy, and if now both are below the Fermi energy, they can both be filled with an electron. It's just a random process. Either you get a spin down or a spin up. In either case, you see, first of all, as you change the gate voltage, that charge sensor also reacts, because it also reacts to gate voltages. But then a little bit later, there's another jump, and that marks the event where an electron tunnels from the reservoir into the dot. That would be this feature. Okay, so now we have an electron in the dot, but we still don't know anything about its state. The trick now is to bring the voltage back up a little bit again, such that the excited state is above the Fermi level, but the ground state is below the Fermi level, which means that the excited level can hop out. And this means that for some time, while the electron is outside the dot, the conductance of the charge sensor again goes up, just as it has gone down here. As the electron hops out, it goes up again. This step is just from the voltage, the gate voltage change. Whereas if it's in the ground state, it's below the Fermi energy and it's caught into the dot, in the dot. Now, if we wait a little bit, if an electron has hopped out here, it's now possible for another electron here to go in, and that means that the conductance drops again, and now we can actually repeat the cycle, bring all the electrons back up again, or both states above the Fermi energy, and the electron hops out. And so what we see is that if we had a spin, an excited state, a spin down electron, we had this little dip here in the charge sensor conductance versus time, whereas if it was a down state, you know, on the black line, nothing happened. So much for the theory. Here's the experiment from a group in Delft. Two different representative traces. Here you see no spin event. Here you see this little blip that told you the spin was originally in an up state, or in a down state. Spin up, spin down, down state, excited state. So this shows us one key requirement for qubits. How can we read out the spin or the state of a qubit that is encoded in a single electron spin? This was done by the American Gallium Arsenide. Now, once you can read out a state, you can start to ask about its dynamics. And one possibility is to ask how fast is the mixture that we've prepared. So we've prepared a statistical mixture of up, up, and down, down. How fast does that, or how long does that take until it decays to the ground state, which is an up, up? Eventually, that should happen because the temperature is lower than the splitting between these two states. In equilibrium, you would expect to be mostly in this state. And, well, in this particular experiment, they saw that at high fields, the decay time is about less than a millisecond at a field of 10 tesla. But the detailed investigation shows that if you reduce the field from a few tesla to about 1 tesla, then the rate at which this decays, so 1 over the decay time, 1 over T1 time, can decrease all the way to 1 hertz, which means that lifetimes on the order of 1 second are possible for an individual spin. So the physics behind that is spin-orbit coupling and phonon relaxation, so the way a spin relaxes is that it's basically shaken a little bit by zero-point fluctuations in the photons, in the phonons, and because of spin-orbit coupling that couples orbital motion to spin motion, that can lead to a relaxation of the spin. So the energy is given to the spin bath, and these long times emerge because at low fields you have very little energy and the low phonon density of states, and furthermore, the stronger the electron is confined, the less centrifugal about and the slower it relaxes. Alright, so the relaxation time is of course the first requirement for developing qubits. And so this is already a pretty nice starting ground, but one needs to go much further. So I think Bloch sphere, I'm familiar with, so I can skip that representation of states as well. Rabi control. Okay, so maybe one thing to briefly touch on. If you now want to control a qubit, a very standard technique that works across all systems, superconducting qubits, optical systems, driving transitions, molecules, and spins, is so-called Rabi flopping. So let's see if I can give you a Hamiltonian. Well, let's say this. So you have a Hamiltonian represented by these precession frequencies. Remember that any Hamiltonian on the Bloch sphere corresponds to rotation. What is often not possible in the experiment is to completely switch your axis around which you rotate, because that will require large changes of the Hamiltonian. What you instead do is just wiggle the axis a little bit like this, meaning that you have a strong splitting in one direction, and for spins this would be an external Zeeman field, and you can provide AC fields that would be at least have some component perpendicular to this field that leads to this wiggling of the precession axis. And if you do that resonantly with the spin precession, then whenever the spin precesses, or the qubit state precesses around the Bloch sphere, this axis has changed direction. And that means that gradually this qubit state can make this screwing motion from the top to the bottom, which is called Rabi oscillation. Formally, you basically transform into a rotating frame or frame rotating along with the qubit and transform your AC Hamiltonian, which is a small drive, into a time-dependent Hamiltonian or time-independent Hamiltonian, where the Z component corresponds to the difference between your AC driving frequency and the qubit level splitting. So it's zero if you're exactly on resonance. And the X component corresponds to your driving field. So you see that if you're on resonance in the rotating frame, you can drive rotation from the 0 to 1 state. So this is really one central technique for qubit control, so it's worthwhile understanding that in detail. So let's see how this can be done for spin qubits. As I said, for spin qubits, the different axes of the Hamiltonian correspond to external magnetic fields. The Hamiltonian is just a B dot S operator. And so we typically apply a large external field and then a small transverse driving field, which for example can be generated by microwave antenna. So this is basically a macroscopic wire, so which can send a current at microwave frequencies, which then generates an additional time-dependent magnetic field on the side of the electron spin, which can also be an addition from all these pulses. And, well, one thing you can do is measure, basically, this is again a current through some part of the device similar to the charge sensor, that you basically measure the probability of being in a spin-up state after a certain amount of time. If you have zero magnetic fields, then nothing prevents the spin from flipping due to other effects. It's happened to be nuclear spins. So at zero magnetic field, you see a higher spin-up probability or spin-flip probability, than non-zero magnetic fields. But if you now add microwaves, switch on the microwave drive, this is still without any RF drive, then you suddenly see that there's additional peaks where the electrons can flip, and that is whenever the resonance condition is met. And then you can vary the look at how this frequency at which these transitions occur depend on the magnetic field, and you see those two branches that just correspond to the fact that the resonance condition is proportional to the external magnetic field. Here's the spectrum. Splitting between spin up and down is proportional to the field, to standard Zeeman Hamiltonian. Yes?
So what is BAC?
So BAC here is an AC magnetic field that, so you send a current through the strip line at up to microwave frequencies. That current flow generates a magnetic field that wraps around this antenna, but the spin itself basically sees a field that roughly points into the board at the side of the cube.
Okay,
if
we make the field outside the board, then does it change direction of your AC?
Well, so you need to make sure, not much, you need to make sure that the AC field has some component perpendicular to the driving field. So if you go back to the Rabi Hamiltonian, so you always have an external magnetic field. In this case it's in plane, but that's secondary. If you only to modulate the field, the external field, and basically change the rate of precession, then your qubit would always process around the same axis, but sometimes would be a little bit faster, sometimes a little bit slower. So you need to make sure that there's some component that's perpendicular. As long as that is fulfilled, you're pretty much free to rotate things around. The qubits don't like it so much when they have like external perpendicular fields, so that's why this is applied in plane. But for example, if you rotate everything around the z-axis, nothing will change. All right. So we can do spectroscopy, we can see the resonance condition, and thus read the level splitting. The next thing is then to vary the time for which the microwaves are applied. This is shown here on the x-axis, and again you see the probability of flipping a spin, or current is proportional to that. And if you take a cut here, you see that as a function of time, so the longer you apply the pulse, the electron flips, goes back, and so on. And the rate at which this happens, so the frequency of these oscillations, increases as one sends more power down the strip line, meaning one creates a stronger AC magnetic field which drives the qubits faster. Here again cuts, so you see roughly these oscillations which become faster as the transfers are always increased. Now again, this is one of the first demonstrations that can be done. But if you look at these curves, what you would expect ideally is the qubit just rotates around the Gauss sphere like this. So if you really measure the probability of being up or down spin, this should be a nice sine wave. And these are certainly not nice sine waves. They lose a lot of ground pass and have this funny wavy shape. And this can all be tracked back to nuclear spin fluctuations. We're still going to have mass net quantum logistic variance. You can also show the frequency again is proportional to the current as it goes. Now this is where silicon comes again. Not very long ago, people have learned to do the same kind of experiments in various types of silicon devices. So in this case, we are looking at a quantum dot. I'm sorry, the drawing is maybe a little bit crowded. It's basically based on the same principle, except that now the electrons are captured or confined at an interface between silicon and silicon oxide. It's done by an Australian group, so you again have an electron wave function here. There's also a quantum dot operator with a charge sensor. Here you see the device. It's a little bit unclear what these gates all do, but they essentially implement the same kind of trapping potential as I've shown you before. But here it's more challenging because everything needs to be smaller. It's a part of the silicon. Again, you have the strip line here generating the AC magnetic field. And now if you do exactly the same magnetic field, you apply a control pulse, a microwave pulse, for some limited amount of time and ask, has the electron flipped or not? And then do the spin selective readout. Is it in the up state or down state, which leads to a tunneling event or not, just as we've discussed. You see very beautiful Samuelson Rabi oscillations. And you also see that on the scale here of a few microseconds, these seem to be not a decay at all, or maybe just see a little bit. Looks like it would go on forever, and that reflects the excellent properties, coherence properties of silicon. And I think this is all the isotopically purified with all
sitting in his nuclear splint removed. I'll say more about that.
Alright, so this, if you could say we stop here, we can know how we can control individual spins. But there's a few problems. Well, first of all, it gets boring for physicists, but more important is if you need this bulky strip line here next to the qubit, it's not very convenient. You need to, would have to place many of them somewhere in close proximity if you want to drive many qubits. So if you already want to build a quantum computer, you imagine having many qubits next to each other. Then you need a relatively large current through the strip line in order to generate enough magnetic field. That tends to generate heating problems, so power limited. Then it tends to also create undesirable electrical fields. And furthermore, magnetic fields penetrate most materials. It's difficult to screen them, especially on this length scale. So it means it's quite difficult to address individual qubits. So all of these problems would be less severe if you can use electric fields, because then your device could look much simpler. You just take a standard quantum dot without this big microwave antenna, apply an AC magnetic field to a gate that you already have, and could use that to control the qubits. But of course the problem is how do you use electrical fields to control the spin, which primarily couples to magnetic fields. Well, there are several answers to that, and one is to use spin-orbit coupling, the same mechanism that I've already discussed in the context of relaxation. The basic physics is if you take an electron and you move it in the solid state, in the solid state there's always electric fields from the atomic lattice. Through relativity, in the moving frame of the electron, the electric field gets turned into an effective magnetic field. That's the basic Lorentz transformation. And now if you look at, this magnetic field would again rotate the spin, think there's no external magnetic field. The spin sees the magnetic field, it processes around that. You know that the rotation angle is proportional to the velocity, so the magnetic field, and therefore to the velocity times the time, and therefore it's proportional to the distance that the electron travels. So you can think of if an electron moves back and forth, it simultaneously rotates its direction, no matter how fast or slow you move it. Whenever it's on the left, it points this way. When it's on the right, it points this way. And now, if you go into the reference frame of the electron, that toggles like this and have an addition, an external magnetic field, this will look like the magnetic field toggles back and forth. And that means we have exactly the condition we need in order to drive an electron. You have a field whose transverse components oscillates as the electron is moved back and forth. So all you have to do now is to rotate or to move this electron back and forth in resonance with the Zeeman precession of the qubit. For the more mathematically minded among you, just probably the majority is the corresponding control Hamiltonian. You have an external field and you have the spin orbit field, which is orthogonal due to the external field from its cross product. And its magnitude depends on the current position of the electron with this vector n and spin-orbit coupling constants. So alpha and beta are constants that tell you how much the electron spin rotates and our material properties. And, well, so all we have to do now is wiggle this electron, and as I say, this creates an effective AC magnetic field. If we see if this is at resonance with the external field, which should drive spin positions. And the Delft group has also done this experiment. Again, here you see the probability of flipping a spin as a function of the time. Here you see actually surprisingly nice sinusoidal oscillation, still going oscillate with nuclear spins. And what also sees that the frequency at which this happens is proportional to the external drive frequency, which in turn is proportional to the at resonance to the external magnetic field, because frequency must always match the Zeeman splitting. And this is expected for the spin-orbit coupling mechanism, where this effective transverse magnetic field that does the driving is proportional to the external field, that was on the previous slide. And well, this is exactly what you see and confirms that one really drives the spin-orbit. So this is one approach. The spin-orbit coupling uses an intrinsic property of the material. which by the way is not very strong in silicon, so this might not work so well. Another possibility is to use a micromagnet, a small piece of cobalt for example, which generates a local dipole field or spatially inhomogeneous magnetic field. So as one again moves an electron in the field of this micromagnet, it will see through a spatial motion time-dependent local magnetic field, and the same thing can be used to again drive transitions. And recently people have realized to optimize this design by making the geometry of this micromagnet optimal and shown that one can reach driving speeds on the order of 4 nanoseconds. So here you do a pi pulse from 0 to maximum in 4 nanoseconds. If you compare that to previous approaches, this took more on the order of 100 nanoseconds or so. And if you can do things faster, that always means you can do them more easily before the electron loses its coherence and can reach a higher fidelity. So in this case, which for AC control in gallium arsenide, the fidelity is 96%. For reference, to do serious quantum computing, you would need about 99.9. So there's still a bit to go, but one order of magnitude. Okay, so much about spin control. So this is all I would say about individual spins. Now in principle, once you can control spins, you can measure them, you can also measure the coherence. And people have done that pretty much as soon as they realized they had a qubit. And for a long time, until about 2010, the results looked like this, T2 star. So it's one measure of coherence, the time over which the coherence decays when one does nothing to prevent it, and includes the qubit is sensitive to also slow fluctuations, a few tens of nanoseconds, and if one does a spin echo, which is a technique to eliminate slow noise, I'll say more about that, about a microsecond. So, for a long time people thought this was the only thing one could do with these qubits, but I'll say more about that later, and two electron spin qubits were experiments work better and came to much longer times. Alright, so summarizing single spins, they can be read out using this energy selective readout where one spin up state or spin down tunnels out of the dot, the spin up stays in. They can be controlled via Rabi oscillation using either magnetic or electric fields, and for the latter one uses either spin orbit interaction or micromagnets. Of course, alternatives, but these are the mainstream approaches. Any questions on that so far?
We have a question, I think we can ask you later, because we have many questions we have, but after this presentation, I would like to
ask. Okay, sure. Yeah. Alright, so let's come to two electron spin qubits. I'd first like to discuss the general idea of encoding qubits in several spins, so moving away from this idea that spin equals qubit. Then say a little bit about the control principles and energy levels of particular two electron spin qubits, where one uses two electrons. Then discuss single shot radars, and then again go more into more details regarding coherence. So, as I said, the most natural way to encode a qubit might be to just use a spin down or spin up and down, which is by itself a qubit. But in principle, you can use any two-dimensional subspace of a broader Hilbert space of any quantum system as a qubit. Typically, these are the two lowest levels, but one could also use higher levels as long as the decay is not too fast. And then just say, okay, our physical system has many quantum states, but the one we use for a qubit state is just a subset of. Why would one do that? Well, first of all, many quantum systems, including superconducting qubits, they come with many states and it's difficult to get rid of them. It's actually quite a big problem for superconducting qubits. So first of all, you get a wider choice of qubits. Then in some cases, you can get so-called decoherence-free subspaces. Free is a bit of an exaggeration, it always depends on the assumptions, but at least you can reduce certain decoherence channels by choosing states that don't react to certain external perturbations. And what is, I think, most important is you can reduce the control requirements. So, for example, work without magnetic fields. However, there's also additional disadvantages. First of all, control and the devices tend to become more complex. For example, you add more spins, you need more spins. And the leakage out of the logical subspace. So if the qubit suddenly decides to go to this level, which is not a valid computational state, can produce additional errors that we need to worry about, characterize, and prevent. So the type of qubit I'd like to present, a coded qubit I'd like to discuss in detail, as I said, two electron spin qubits. And the big advantage here is that if you use two electrons, they can interact via the exchange interaction, and we can now use that to control the qubit. And that is attractive because the exchange interaction can be controlled as well through electric fields. It can be made very strong, so this gives us a very convenient, entirely electrical control knob that is faster than what I've discussed before, and you don't necessarily need microwaves, so in some way it greatly simplifies qubit control, but at the expense of needing two spins rather than one for a qubit. Now if you have four spins, the total Hilbert space, one basis would be this one. And what turned out to be most convenient, or at least most explored so far, is to use the two m equals zero states, the singlet and the t0, being symmetric or anti-symmetric combinations of the two anti-parallel states as basis states, and basically for most purposes forget about the m equals plus minus one states with most spins aligned. So this is our qubit subspace. Now how can these be controlled? It's useful to discuss the dynamics again. One important part is now a magnetic field gradient. If the two spins see a different magnetic field on the left and the right, that means that up-down and down-up, so it should be different, states have different energies and require a relative phase. If you look at that on the Bloch sphere, it corresponds to a precession on the z-axis with a rate proportional to this magnetic field gradient. And second, you have an exchange interaction between the two spins. I like to physically think of the two spins coherently swapping places, and from that you can see, well, either through that picture, also saying that the exchange splitting splits the singlet and the m equals 0 triplet, our second basis states. In any case, you see that this drives a rotation of the qubit around the x-axis, split up again, or swaps the two spins. So now we have again two axes that are orthogonal, and that can in principle be used to completely control the qubit. So just as a recap, let's compare the two. In a single spin qubit, one uses the external magnetic field, the total field, to obtain the level splitting. In this case, it's a field difference between the two dots. In a single spin qubit, one needs a transverse magnetic or effective magnetic field to drive rotations. In this case, the rotations on the x-axis can be driven by the exchange interaction, and it's possible to make this much larger than this magnetic field gradient. There's no hardly any limit to that, it's only limited by practical considerations and the level splitting, of course, eventually. So now to go into more detail and understand how these qubits are operated, it's useful to introduce the energy level diagram, which shows the energy of the different states as a function of the tuning, called epsilon, or denoted by epsilon. And this detuning is the energy difference between the state where the two electrons are separated and the state where the two electrons are both in one dot. And it can be controlled by applying voltages to these gates. So we can basically think of that as the difference between the gate voltages on the left and right, which tilts this potential and makes either one or the other state more favorable. Let me just see what else I have. Well, now, the key ideas for understanding is that the singlet can, as one tilts the energy state, can tunnel from the left to right. So the two electrons first separated can both be joined into one dot, and because of the tunnel coupling, this gives you a standard avoided crossing, these two hyperbolas. Whereas if you had a triplet state, the triplet in the ZO2 configuration has a higher energy, because they cannot both occupy the ground state. That means for triplet, tunneling is forbidden, and the triplet remains in a 1-1 state and thus has this trivial linear dispersion, so linear detuning dependence. And it's this difference between singlet and triplet which is used. So if we now want to operate the qubit, there's different positions on the detuning axis where one can manipulate it. You're on the far left, you can think of the electrons being completely separated, they don't talk to each other, there's no exchange interaction, it's completely suppressed, and that means they only see this Zeeman field difference from the magnetic field gradient driving this X-DAC rotation around the Gauss field. If we go to slightly negatively tuning, then the states are still nearly 1-1, but we start to have a splitting, the so-called exchange splitting or exchange coupling between these two states. So this is where the exchange interaction comes from, which, as I've said, drives the rotation on the x-axis, and that's based on allowing a virtual occupation of the doubly occupied state, which is 0-2 here, which allows the two electrons to swap spaces in a derivative sense. And then there's another point that is important, not so much for qubit operation, but for certain other experiments. If you zoom in onto this crossing between the singlet and the m equals plus 1 triplet, the t plus, which appears here, you zoom in enough, it's an avoided crossing where transitions are driven by a transverse magnetic field, and that can be used to let the electrons talk to nuclear spins once we add here nuclear spins to the system. So I'll say, come back to that later. Alright, so you have the basic, on a mathematical level, the basic control principles. Before I come to experiments that actually utilize them to control the qubits, I'd like to discuss one more aspect, namely single shot readout. How can one read out these qubits? And because the technical part of that are quite representative also what is used for other types of qubits. So first of all, how does the physics work? I've already told you that if you go towards the right to positively tuning, the singlet can tunnel from 1-1 to 0-2, so you can bring the two electrons together, whereas for a triplet, this is not possible. And the good thing is that once you're in a triplet, and go over here, this triplet is relatively stable, it takes a few microseconds to decay, and so this allows you to distinguish these two states. So if you're in a singlet, you tilt your potential, the two electrons will join. You start in a singlet over here, tilt it, the two electrons go together. You can read a 0-2-like charge signal with your charge sensor. If you do the same thing with a triplet, the two electrons are stuck in the 1-1, in the separated configuration, you will read a different charge sensor. So, this is nice, but doing this, or in theory, doing this fast enough to really distinguish an individual state is not trivial. And the ability to do so is called single shot readout, meaning to distinguish the state of a qubit not only on average over many repetitions, but each and every single time you do an experiment on the qubit. And that is important for a range of applications. For example, if you want to do error correction, you want to know has an error occurred or not. For that, you need to have a high readout fidelity. If you want to verify entanglement or do Belt inequalities, you need to measure correlation between individual qubits, and that pretty much needs single-shot readout. If you want to do fundamental studies, determine the properties of predictive measurements, it's useful. And finally, it allows pretty fast and accurate data acquisition, so it's nice from a practical point of view. And what you need in order to get the single-shot readout is the technique is to distinguish the two qubit states, say singlet and triplet, before they have time to decay. And, well, the method of choice is actually quite similar to what you may have seen for superconducting qubits, but fortunately it's a little bit simpler and the amplifier requirements are less challenging. But when you nevertheless use microwave engineering, so we still want to measure the conductance of this charge sensor here, in this case a quantum point contact. But in order to do that fast and with high sensitivity, well, there's two things we'd like to have. First of all, is a high bandwidth, so in order to measure quickly. And second, it's nice to use high sensitivity cold amplifiers that can be cooled and thus right to reach a higher sensitivity. But the problem with that is both of these are challenging if you're not working in a 50 ohm environment. So all the electrical engineering or microwave technologies that are available are typically at 50 ohms. But the conductance of these sensors is basically one conductance quantum, so on the scale of about less than a conductance quantum. The resistance would be on the order of 50 kilo ohms, so we have about 3 orders of magnitude impedance mismatch to bridge. The first thing one does is to add a tank circuit, basically an LC resonator that acts as an impedance matcher, basically changes the current and voltage level such that they are palatable to a qubit. And then attached to that, microwave engineering or RF engineering chain. I'm not going to go through all the details, but essentially you generate a signal, send it down to the qubit. Then, depending on what the conductance is here, more or less of the signal will be dissipated by the qubit. Whatever is not dissipated is reflected back, goes back the same way, is now coupled into the amplifier chain by a directional coupler, even called amplifier, and amplified. And then you basically measure how much of the signal arrives at the top. And again, the total amount of signal reflected then depends on this conductance here, which in turn has a qubit conductance. And now if you look at the performance of that, here's a sensor signal from the first demonstration of this technique as a function of time. Each region here corresponds to one pulse. So you can already see that the blue one and the green one have different levels. There's a bit of wiggling around, that is the residual noise. You see that the bandwidth is on the order of megahertz, with time changes taking place on a scale of time, microseconds. And, well, it's already nice that we see two levels here. These turn out to correspond to the different qubit levels. If you now average over some of these regions to gain more signal and plot a histogram of the two possible values, you indeed see that double Gaussian distribution of the possible measurements. So this is the average voltage axis on the x-axis. This is the probability of measuring this. And each of these peaks can be attributed or associated with one of the qubit states. The fact that they are well separated with only small overlap tells you that they have fairly high single shot fidelity. You can set a threshold here and say anything to the left is a singlet, anything to the right is a triplet. Now, one can do a little bit better even if one changes the charge sensor, if one goes away from a quantum point contact to a quantum dot, which is basically again very similar to the qubit. So an isolated level with two leads attached. It turns out that the sensor is more sensitive than a single quantum point contact by about a factor of 3. And now the same kind of data shown here in color plot shows that this would be for the quantum dot, for the quantum point contact. Here's the averaging time. Here's again the color-coded histogram. You see that after only about a microsecond of averaging, the two histograms are nearly completely separated, have no overlap anymore, so that you would expect a near-perfect single-shot readout. And in practice, this going from one to the other is about a factor of 10 reduction in sensitivity. So, summarizing, the basic physics for readout is spin-to-charge conversion. You map spin state, singlet or triplet onto a charge configuration by trying to bring the two electrons together. If it works, it's a singlet. If it doesn't work, it's a triplet. And then use a charge sensor to determine the difference between these two charge states. It's my schematic charge sensor again before this excited triplet can decay. And by using RF techniques, this can be done, or it's good enough to reach single shot readout fidelity performance. And the fidelity, I think it has never really been optimized or completely characterized, but it's well in excess of 90%. Maybe for comparison with superconducting qubits, in order to achieve similar capabilities in modern superconducting qubits, they need much fancier amplifiers based on parametric amplification, whereas our first amplifier stage here is a simple semiconductor amplifier with a noise temperature of a couple of Kelvin.
So now I'd like to just briefly outline one additional type of qubit to basically complete your view of the zoo of encoded qubits, and that's the exchange-only qubit. So maybe as a background, you've learned that by going from one to two spins, we can eliminate the need for AC magnetic fields and instead use the exchange interaction, but we still need a magnetic field difference between the two dots in order to have full control of the qubit. Otherwise, you would just have one control axis. If you now add an additional spin, so all of these are supposed to be electrons. I've stole these slides from David DiVincenzo, so the notion of a qubit is more abstract. You see that there's two exchange couplings. You can exchange couple spin 1 with spin 2 and spin 2 with spin 3. So now you have two control knobs that are only used on exchange. And if you now again pick clever qubit states, which you can think of those two. The zero state would be a singlet on the left and a spin up, whereas the the one state would be more complicated combination, but all of them would have an M sub Z of plus 1/2. So again, you pick a certain subspace. Then it turns out that the two axes driven by J12 and J23, one of them is the Z-axis, so you just generate a splitting between them, basically between the T-naught and the singlet. Not sure why that is the case, at least not so quickly. Anyway, you generate a rotation around the Z-axis, but there's a second exchange coupling which generates a rotation around the different axes, and that turns out to point about this way and has an angle of 120 degrees with this axis. So now you again have two axes that you can control independently by switching this exchange and this, use this for complete qubit control. They're not orthogonal, which makes it a little bit complicated, but it works.
Yeah, you have written that the J12 and J2, the direction elements, these are on the one axis where these three, J12, J23, but why are you not including J13?
Okay, so question is why not include J13? It's quite simple. It's much simpler to align the electron spins in a linear chain, and that means the direct exchange coupling from here to here will be quite weak. So it's just a practical matter. Of course, you could also put them in a triangle and then would have all three, but you don't need that. So now you can ask, how do you do gate operations? And well, the paper that introduced these spins theoretically showed that a single qubit gate, for example, could be done. One way to do that could be done like this, having a sequence of four different interactions between 1 and 2 and 2, 3. And, of course, it depends on which gate you want to do, but this would be a representative solution. If you want to do a two-qubit gate, it becomes more complicated. This is now assuming a linear chain of 6 electrons. All this nearest neighbor exchange coupling, the first two, three make one qubit, the next three make the other qubit, and this complete interaction with these numerically worked out times turn out to lead to either a C phase or a C not gate. So I don't want to go into the detail, but the point is to show that the cost of only using exchange is that the qubit manipulation becomes more complex and you need more steps. There's, of course, refinements. These have improved a little bit, but the overall picture is still representative. Now, people have succeeded in making this work experimentally to some extent. Here you see a triple quantum dot, again with a charge sensor, but these are the qubit states. Here's a charge diagram, which now has, in principle, three control axes. So this is just a two-dimensional cut of a detuning, which is the difference between left and right and some other voltage. And this region in the middle here can be identified with the single occupancy of each dot. And then one can control the qubit essentially by taking cuts along these lines, which is our detuning epsilon. You can look at what the levels look like and come to a result like this. So the singlets, as you cross these transitions, tunnel across into another dot. The same happens each of these two transitions, so that's these branches, whereas the various triplet states would stay in this isolated configuration of separated electrons. And if you plot the qubit like this, again here the slightly different basis states, it's more symmetric. You have two exchange couplings that are 120 degrees apart, and by moving one way on the detuning or the other, the total axis, which is the sum of them, can be tilted between left and right, and this can be used to manipulate the qubit. So here's a proof that it can indeed be manipulated using various pulses, pulsing, well, along this detuning, using ramps and steps. And one sees that these oscillations do occur and roughly look like theoretical models. Depending on to where you jump, the oscillations are faster or slower. It just depends to the different level splitting. And one can also use a tomography technique to visualize the evolution of the qubit that starts out here and then, well, rotates around the blosphere, but at the same time spirals inward due to decoherence. So, well, I think this is about as far as the qubit has been developed. A group of Charlie Marcus, now at Copenhagen, I think I'll leave it there. Maybe a quick comparison between the different spin qubits. We have looked at 1, 2, or 3 spin qubits. What I've listed here is what are the control requirements. Both for static and AC fields, how does one do a 2-qubit gate, and how many steps does one need for a 2-qubit gate. So for single spin we need a magnetic field, for 2 spins we need a magnetic field difference in order to manipulate it. For a 3-spin qubit, well, it's useful to have a magnetic field in order to separate the levels, but in principle you need nothing at all. For AC control, you need for single spin effective transverse magnetic field, but for the other two you need only exchange interaction. And well, so here more spins make it easier, you have less requirements. If you look at mechanism for 2-qubit gates, we haven't discussed that so much, I'll come to that at the end I hope. You can use exchange for single spins, you can still use exchange in all cases, but the number of steps that one needs in a 2-qubit gate becomes increasingly difficult. So for a single spin, one can essentially do it in a single step. You just use exchange between 2 spins that are each an individual qubit that can directly implement the 2-qubit gates. If one uses exchange for 2 spins, one needs something like 2 to 6 steps depending on the exact gate. If one does that for triple spins, one needs these 19 to 27 steps that I've discussed before. So that increases, and for orientation I've also highlighted the experimentally most difficult step. Creating magnetic field difference isn't simple. Creating AC magnetic fields is not simple, and doing many steps is not simple either. So in the end there's trade-offs, and it's hard to say which qubit really works best. Alright, any other question on the triple spin qubits? Okay, so then I'd like to move on to decoherence. First maybe cover some basic concepts to recap the characteristic timescales, and then focus a fair bit on the hyperfine interaction, the nuclear spins, and also say something about exchange dephasing of this exchange operation. Well, so first of all, why is decoherence important? I think I can do this quickly. You know that qubits are essentially analog because they need this phase information, and that means that very small errors already matter. You don't have the same protection as in digital technology. And second, because you're using the phase, as soon as any information about the state of the qubit, is it in 0 or 1, leaks into any uncontrolled degree of freedom, your environment, you dephase the qubit. So basically you want to completely isolate the qubit. On the other hand, you need to manipulate it. At the end of the day, or your calculation, you want to read it out, and you have to couple qubits to each other. And so that means you have conflicting requirements. You need to very tightly control if something couples to the qubit or not, and basically switch that on and off over pretty large dynamic range on pretty small structures. And well, luckily there's the theory of quantum error correction and the threshold theorem that says you don't need to do all this perfectly, all you have to do is reach about 10 to the 3 coherent operations before an error occurs, or an error probability per operation should be about 10 to minus 3, and loosely speaking that means, depending on some details, the speed of the operation of the qubit should at least be about 1,000 times faster than the time it takes to decohere. And that's why people care much about coherence times. So in general, coherent decoherence is the loss of information, I think you know that. Very briefly, the time scales, maybe they are less familiar in a more theoretical setting. There's one type of decoherence is that the excited state decays into the ground state. This energy relaxation process is called the T1 process, and the time scale at which this happens is called T1. T1 is the energy relaxation time. This is usually a Markovian process with an exponential decay. And as we've discussed for spins, this can be in the seconds, so we typically just ignore it and don't worry much about it. It may sometimes be relevant, but it's not the most important issue. Now, the more interesting part is dephasing, so losing phase information, which always comes about from the level splitting of the qubit fluctuating. If the level splitting fluctuates, then the precession frequency of the qubit fluctuates, and after some time you don't know how fast it has precessed, and the pure initial state has been smeared out into some mixed state, and well, that's the coherence. There's two, in principle there's an infinitely many time scales on which this happens depending on the protocol, but there are two that are prominent and typically used as a first order approximation, so to speak. One is the so-called T2, which refers to true decoherence, say due to uncorrelated noise that cannot be recovered and really leads to errors. And this is in some sense a fundamental criterion. And then there's a T2 star, which arises from fast and in particular slow fluctuations. For example, when you repeat many measurements, each measurement the qubit sees a slightly different environment. And this is typically shorter than T2, but you can play tricks because the errors are strongly correlated. If you do the same thing immediately again, you often get the same answer. One can play tricks to beat that, and it's not as fundamental a limit. But devils are in the detail. Well, and as I said, if you have Markovian noise, so an exponential decay, then a much rough measure of the error probability, or actually in that case it's an accurate measure, is the time per operation divided by the time it takes to decay. But once you have non-Markovian noise where correlation matters, that breaks down, you can get all sorts of powers, so need to be careful with that. Alright, anyway, what you should be familiar with is the difference between T2 and T2 star. So now for looking at spin qubits, which are the dominant noise sources, generally there's two, as for any qubits. There's a local environment, that's where the physics happens, but then there's also external electrical noise. The local environment, the most important things are fluctuating spins, either from electrons if there are any, but most important from nuclear spins. And in gallium arsenide, this is the, in some sense, most prominent and most obvious source of decoherence. There's phonons. These are responsible for the relaxation, as we've discussed. It's not clear that they have any significant impact on dephasing, at least that hasn't been observed yet. There's charge traps. If there's charge noise in the environment, that can also affect the qubit, and that is, well, certainly has been turned out to be important, but it depends a lot on the sample and can be improved with better material design, but it's a pretty tedious business. Then on top of that, there's of course electrical noise. The pulse generators that you use to control the qubits are typically noisy, the same the voltage sources. There's radio stations that aren't perfectly isolated that make it into a fridge. There are always resistors at finite temperatures that create Johnson noise. So all of these have to be considered. In principle, they're avoidable with proper engineering, but it's sometimes tedious, and I don't think that has been fully addressed yet. So let's come to the hyperfine interaction as one interesting source. So if you look at a gallium arsenide electron, it's typically confined to about 50 nanometers an hour double well potential. It means it couples to roughly an order of a million nuclear spins that occupy the same region of space. In gallium arsenide, you cannot get rid of the spins. And the coupling Hamiltonian turns out to be basically an Ising type Hamiltonian with the dot product of the electron spin operator and the individual nuclear spin operator, with coupling constants that are proportional to the probability of the electron being at the site of each nucleus, namely the envelope wave function squared. If you're interested in how this comes about, you can think of each nucleus as a little dipole, a little coil that generates a magnetic moment. And you can then relate the field outside of the this little coil integrates out and averages to zero for a smooth electron. But there's also a field inside. You can relate that to the dipole moment. And if you then ask, well, what is the probability of the electron being inside this coil times the strength of the fields, the field inside the coil, turns out that the size of the coil cancels out, you can shrink it to zero, and you just get this delta function like local magnetic field. If you plug that into a Hamiltonian where you say, okay, The electron spin sees a local magnetic field with the probability of being at that position. You just get this hyperfine contact interaction. So I find it kind of neat that you can see this from fairly classical objects. But anyway, so at the end of the day, these nuclear spins have a very small level splitting, so they're in a completely random state. You can think of them as a diagonal density matrix with an infinite temperature. And that means that the field seen by the electron has basically square root n statistics. One nucleus is up, the next one is down in a completely random way. And as a result, the typical magnitude of the effective field, if you just think of this as a field seen by the electron here, is on the order of a few millitesla and scales as coupling constant over square root n. So the more nuclei, the lesser, the weaker this field. If this field was completely static, we would be happy. We have a field, so who cares? It's static, it doesn't decohere. But because the nuclei have their own dynamics, this causes decoherence. And that's not something I'd like to dive in a little bit more detail. What I should say is that the numbers here and most of the experiments are for gallium arsenide, but you encounter very similar physics whenever nuclear spins are present. And for example, in silicon, you have fewer spins, but if you don't purify them, there's very similar things happening. So in that sense, it's of somewhat broader relevance. It's the same in V centers. So the qualitative aspects are quite universal. Now we've said the important thing is the dynamics of the nuclear spins that determines how they relax. There's two aspects. There's flip-flops, so nuclear spins can exchange information, transfer that from one to the other, and if that happens many times, the local polarization can diffuse in and out of the region with a quantum dot, and it turns out that this takes typically, depending on how much of what you want, on the scale of a second to minutes. And that is nice because it means that it's slow enough to probe the nuclear field in real time and even manipulate on its intrinsic time scales, and you don't just need to take the fluctuations as they happen intrinsically. Another aspect that turns out to be very important is the Larmor precession of the nuclear spins. So all the nuclear spins also precess in the external magnetic field, about 3 orders of magnitude slower than the electron. So the time scale is, say, a tenth of a microsecond to a microsecond, depending on the field. And the dephasing time, which also turns out to be important of this precession, is on the scale of 100 microseconds. So all these play some role. So to get you a more detailed sense of how experiments are done on these qubits, and particular experiments to probe the hyperfine field, I'd like to walk you through one particular experimental sequence. So here again is our qubit. We start with 2 electrons in 1 dot. That means they relax into a singlet state, which is the ground state. And on each dot, there are a number of nuclear spins. And what the qubit is sensitive to is the field difference between them. And since global external magnetic fields are pretty homogeneous, the dominant contributing factor is the nuclear field. Since these are different nuclei, they produce different magnetic fields, and this will produce a random field gradient. So anyway, we start with the electrons together, then electrically tilt this potential to bring them apart. This takes about a nanosecond, so not much changes about the state of the electron. Now they see this nuclear spin, which means that the state processes around the z-axis on the Bloch sphere, with these states being the eigenstates, and the frequency or level splitting associated with this precession is proportional to the nuclear spin field difference. Now, after a few nanoseconds, we try to bring the 2 electrons back together. This works if it's in a singlet. It doesn't work if it's in a triplet. So that means the average probability of the electron going back here just corresponds to the singlet and triplet probability and tells us how far this has rotated. So if you repeat this experiment many times to get statistics and vary the evolution time, how much time it has, if you do it quickly enough, you see this oscillation between a singlet and not singlet, the sinusoidal oscillation corresponding to the precession on the Bloch sphere. Now, if you determine the frequency from this oscillation, this frequency is proportional to delta Bz. So any such measurement, which, well, by now takes only, a couple of hundred microseconds if you do it right, gives you an instantaneous measurement of the current value of the nuclear hyperfine field. And then you repeat this many times over and over again. And you can, for example, get a time trace of the hyperfine field gradient as a function of lab time. and see these fluctuations here on a scale of about 10 millitesla. That's the 2 millitesla I mentioned before. So peak to peak is larger than RMS. And this noise here is not measurement noise to a large extent, it's real fluctuation of the nuclear spin. So you can basically sit there and see how these oscillate or how these nuclear spins change their state in real time. Also works in silicon, there's even snow. Okay, so we can measure the nuclear spins quickly, but we can do even better. I've already mentioned this crossing here between T plus and singlet, and if we start on one side and sweep to the other and do that, let's see, is that slowly enough so that we're adiabatic with respect to this avoided crossing, it's possible to transfer angular momentum from the electron to the nuclear spins. And since the transfer goes in opposite direction depending from which state we start from, we can manipulate the nuclear spins in opposite direction, either add or reduce angular momentum, and thus control them in both directions. And what is not entirely obvious but turns out to work, probably because the dots have different sizes, but that's not completely established, is that one not only builds up an average polarization but also manipulates the gradient. So that's what I just said. If you repeat this many times, if you go in one direction and run about a million cycles per second, you can increase the nuclear field. So again, here you see this time trace of nuclear hyperfine field. First it increases, then you switch the pulse and start with a different initial qubit state to pump in the opposite direction. You can decrease it again, basically go back and forth or any direction you like as you wish. And, well, one possibility but how this can be used, this is the same picture before, is to reach a steady state where there's still fluctuations present, but you now have introduced an average hyperfine field of a few tens of millitesla, or it can even be larger. So this is a nice way of creating these magnetic field gradients that are used or needed for qubit control. So take-home message is you can measure it quickly through these precession frequency measurements of the qubit, and it is possible to also manipulate the hyperfine fields between measurements. And, well, what I'd like to show you is how this ability can be used to actually reduce the fluctuations and reduce the coherence time. So if you just let these fluctuations run and measure T2 star, basically average many of these oscillations together, in order to measure the average decay of qubit coherence, you get something that looks like this. It oscillates at the mean value of the hyperfine field between singlet and triplet, but after a time scale that is given by the width of these fluctuations, typically about 10 nanoseconds, it has decayed to zero. And the reason that this happens faster than in the individual traces is that many phases with different frequencies are averaged together. Sometimes it's a little bit faster, sometimes it's a little bit slower, so eventually they interfere destructively and nothing is visible. Now this seems like, since this scales with 1 over square root n and the coupling constant, there's not much you can do about that with sample design. But with our feedback and manipulation technique, you can steer the nuclear spins, and if you now introduce feedback to always push them back to the value you would like to have, you can see here that fluctuations can be suppressed and become much quieter. Now this already gives about a factor of 2 increase in T2 star, and could be pushed further. But a neat way to automate that further and simplify the procedure and improve the performance is to use the qubit itself as a feedback loop. So maybe this is the first quantum processor that does actually something useful. And the idea here is to, again, initialize a singlet, but then first let the qubit evolve under the current hyperfine field, let it process, and only then attempt to transfer angular momentum to the nuclear spins. So if during the precession the qubit comes back to a singlet, then we can go through this crossing and we transfer angular momentum. This means that our hyperfine field changes and we are manipulating the external field and will, for example, increase. So the precession frequency also increases, but at some point, after enough increase, we do the same thing again, the qubit in the same evolution time processes further, and if we now try to polarize, we stay on the upper branch in the triplet, because now the qubit has processed to a triplet before the polarization step, and that means nothing happens, and the field would decrease again. And well, what happens in practice is that the whole system, if you do it right, settles at a fixed point where the fluctuations are strongly suppressed. And so far, the best we've achieved is that is an extension of the coherence time by about an order of magnitude, 250-ish nanoseconds, which goes along with a narrowing of the distribution of this hyperfine field. So without feedback, you have this few millitesla fluctuation in the distribution of hyperfine field values. Once you switch on feedback, this is narrowed significantly. So on the one hand, it's kind of fun physics to play with, but it also is really practical and has been turned into a useful resource for controlling these type of qubits and extending their coherence again. So maybe a few more things if you really push. This is more recent work from my previous group at Harvard that they continued after I left. If you really ask how fast can you measure the qubit, how fast can you extract the information, you can push it much beyond this kind of second sampling time scale that the previous data involved. So for example, here you see individual histograms as a function of evolution time of the qubit for 150 repetitions. So I think this is 150 data points at each evolution. And so you see whenever you make a trial, some pixel sees a higher probability, but it's fluctuating a fair bit. If you average over the probabilities, over the different events, you still see the somewhat noisy oscillation. If you do the same thing with 30,000 repetitions, there's hardly any noise left, and you see this T2 star decay. Well, as you see, with 150, you already have enough information to see something reasonable, but you can ask, how can you do even better? How can one most effectively extract the information on the current hyperfield value from the qubit? And the faster you can measure, the better, easier it is to counteract effects. And it turns out that the best protocol is to use a Bayesian estimate, meaning that whenever you do a single measurement on the qubit, for some evolution time, you measure it's in one or zero state with single shot readout, you update your probability distribution, which reflects your knowledge of the nuclear system based on that measurement using a Bayesian procedure. So mathematically, you have this probability distribution of the delta BZ value given all the measurements you have taken so far. And they've created this nice movie of an experiment that runs on FPGA. So you start out with a broad distribution, then it oscillates around for a few measurements, but then pretty quickly converges onto a very narrow distribution around one particular value and doesn't fluctuate any much after just a very few or small number of measurements. So you see here this only takes about a few tens of measurements to get a very good information. And since one can now measure much faster than the dynamics of the nuclear spins, one can use that to essentially artificially enhance T2 star. And if you take the time axis of your oscillations and scale it according to the currently measured hyperfine field value, so that basically all oscillations that sometimes are faster and slower are projected onto the same time or same time axis, one finds a corrected T2 star on the order of 3 microseconds. So this is not a classical T2 star, it involves data processing, so it's somewhat artificial, but it's nevertheless a fair game, and this shows that by this technique you can reach up to 3 microseconds. So, okay, maybe 10 minutes, let me see.
A bit more if you need.
Okay. So, let me maybe fast forward a little bit. So this part is something that I also plan to cover this afternoon in more detail, so I think I'll just do this in fast mode. So we're still at nuclear fluctuations, but so far we've talked about averaging over slow fluctuations, so basically how the nuclear field evolves from time to time, from one run to the next. There's a technique called Hahn echo and dynamical decoupling that can also mitigate faster fluctuations and really get insight into dynamics. And the idea here is to, for our qubit, to initialize in some initial state, let it evolve under the influence of whatever noisy field there is, then apply a pi pulse, so do a pi rotation on the Bloch sphere, and then let it evolve for the same amount of time again. Here a nice physical picture is that again the two electrons swap place. So in the pi pulse the two electrons exchange their places here, and that means on average they experience or are in contact with the same nuclear spins. So if the nuclear spins are static on the time scale on which this experiment happens, you would expect to have no phase at all from the nuclear spins. But once you wait long enough for dynamics to occur, then one can learn something about the dynamics. So we've done that experiment, and at low fields, well, important message is you can extend the coherence to about 30 microseconds. So this is a couple of three orders of magnitude longer than the T2 star we've discussed. This reveals the fact that the dynamics of nuclear spins is very slow compared to the manipulation of the qubit. The form of the decay here is roughly e to the minus t to the fourth. That's pretty generic for slow noise, so that's not very surprising. But things become quite interesting if you go to lower fields, where you see these collapses and revivals on a somewhat shorter time scale. Sometimes the qubit coherence completely collapses. This would correspond to zero coherence or zero probability return to the initial state, then recovers at 10 microseconds and then drops again. And then at the intermediate fields, you just see these oscillations. So that partly answers your question about magnetic fields are good. If you want to have good coherence, you better go above a few hundred millitesla. Here's good physics. So let me just see what else comes before I go much into details. Yes. So I think I'll skip the details of the physics here and do this afternoon, but I'd still like to point out these lines here are not data, they are fits to the data points and they agree pretty nicely, and we have a pretty detailed understanding of how these not quite trivial curves come about and what the physics behind that is. It has to do with the Larmor precession of the nuclear spins. Now if you're not so much interested in the physics, that's the part I'm skipping, then you just want to increase coherence times, you can do better than the single Hahn echo experiment and add multiple pi pulses, called in general dynamical decoupling, and theory already predicted that that should perform much better than Hahn echo. You can already see that with for two pulses, rather than waiting for the qubit coherence decay completely, you can think of a restart and basically doing another pi pulse. This should already get you to here, but with higher order correlations, the extensions are already much larger, so they predicted something like microseconds for qubit coherence. And, well, we did that experiment and indeed find that with a few more pulses than they considered, for 16 pulses, we achieve a qubit coherence time on the order of 200 to 300 microseconds with, well, a few details that are not completely well understood, but nevertheless, I think that coherence time is pretty solid. And for gallium-arsenide qubits, this is still the state of the art and shows that they, well, they're not as good as silicon but can be pretty long. Okay, so much about gallium arsenide. By the way, one thing that had to go into this to come from 1 microsecond originally shown to this value was a fair bit of RF optimization. But what I'd like to briefly discuss is the comparison to silicon. If you look at the different isotopes of gallium arsenide, since these are group 3 and group 5 elements, they always have odd nuclear spin, and all isotopes have a spin 3/2. So this means it's not possible to get rid of these nuclear spins. It's possible to counteract the fluctuation, play tricks to reduce them, but it's clear that for the purpose of quantum computing, that imposes quite an overhead that it would be nice to avoid. And the gate fidelities, I'll say more about this afternoon, still need to be improved in gallium arsenide. So one attractive way is to use silicon here, which has only 1 5% abundance isotope with spin 1/2. Everything else has spin 0. So, and furthermore, it has a weaker hyperfine coupling and fewer spins. So if you isotopically purify the silicon, removing these 5% to a few ppm, then in the bulk, so not qubits but large crystals, people have shown that electron spins can have coherence times on the scale of 10 seconds. And for nuclear spins, the phosphorus 31 nucleus of an individual donor can have coherence times on a scale of 3 hours or even 30 minutes at room temperature. So it would be very nice to leverage this for qubit design, and as I've already alluded to, there are a number of groups, a number of results that have been quite successful as doing this. One approach are these metal oxide silicon dots that I've already briefly mentioned early on, these nice Rabi oscillations, where electrons are confined between silicon and the silicon oxide interface, otherwise very similar to gallium arsenide heterostructures from the kind of device idea. Then one can use phosphorus donors, so individual donors in a similar structure to combine fine individual electrons, manipulate these. This is also an Australian group. And the third mainstream approach that is also quite similar to, or it's most similar to what we do in gallium arsenide, is to use silicon that is sandwiched between silicon germanium, which introduces strain. That strain of the silicon layer induces a band gap offset, and again we have now confinement of electrons in this quantum well. And if you look at the coherence times now in qubit devices, not in the bulk, they're approaching 1 second for electrons and longer for the nucleus. If you look at single qubit error rates, they are on the range of, if one isotopically purifies, 0.1% has been demonstrated, so this is what is needed for single qubits for error correction, and there are some first results for 2-qubit gate, or at least the basic ingredients for 2-qubit operations. So as far as fidelities go, silicon is clearly in the lead, and it's much simpler once you have good devices to reach that. But then again, if you look at these structures, they're either very small and difficult to scale up, and the material quality is sometimes still a bit of a matter of chance. So I think it's still a little bit open which material is best for really scaling up and going to large systems. Okay, so let's see. I have 4 more minutes, so I'd like to say a few things about 2-qubit operations. Because all we've done so far are single qubit operations, but to do quantum computing you need to couple qubits. And, well, one important ingredient for that is actually, so it's not quite just 2-qubit yet, is exchange operation. Everything I've talked to about so far regarding coherence was over here, was completely separated electrons. If you go to where exchange coupling is on, any electrical noise that basically wiggles you about this axis will also lead to dephasing. That has already been realized quite some, well, based on the first experiments on this qubit, one saw something like 3 coherent oscillations of this exchange operation around this axis. Let's skip that. By now we know this a little bit better, but the values are quite similar. What you see is, no matter how fast the exchange oscillations are, one always sees on the order of 10 coherent oscillations before they decay. At some point it becomes less, that's the nucleus, due to nuclear spins. And that is because the further you go towards the right here, the bigger the splitting, so they become faster, but also the sensitivity to charge noise becomes bigger. And all of this data can essentially be explained with RMS slow of charge noise with an amplitude of about 8 microvolts. And throughout all samples that people have measured different groups, there's, well, maybe half an order of magnitude variation in this number, but it seems pretty characteristic for most heterostructures, or most semiconductor samples actually. Always a few microvolts. You can also go beyond and do again echo. So this is again the same Hahn echo as before, except that the two axes are interchanged. You now have an evolution around J, and use delta BZ to implement the pi pulse, and then we can again do an echo measurement, and the best results, and well, pretty much only ones that exist on this measurement, but not all samples are that good, give coherence times on the scale of a few microseconds. Again, it depends on how strongly you drive the qubit, and the more representative number is what we call the Q factor. How many oscillations can you do before the qubit decays, and this is typically a few hundred, which is already pretty good. And all of that can be explained with a noise spectrum that scales roughly as 1 over frequency to 0.7. So 1 over F-like noise, which I think likely originates from some charge traps, maybe the dopants, but that is not firmly established. One thing that is interesting is if you look at the temperature dependence of this noise spectrum, one finds a temperature squared dependence, so temperature turns out to be pretty important, and that is not understood at all in detail. can cook up models to reproduce that, but they're, well, fairly arbitrary. Alright, so one thing I'd like to talk about more about this afternoon, is some more recent work, is how one can turn these reasonably good coherence values into gate fidelities and what gates, well, how can one do that and what gate fidelities can be reached. But I'll show you this in theory. One should, even in the presence of nuclear spins, they should enable gate fidelities or error rates near the value required for quantum error correction. What we've demonstrated so far still has about an order of magnitude to go, but we think that's because of higher charge noise in our samples. All right. I don't know.
Should I?
Okay, so let's. Few things on 2-qubit gates. I'll try to do that relatively quickly. So one option to do 2-qubit gates on spins is to use the same exchange interaction that we use for 2-electron spin qubits to control a single qubit to, if you think of one spin, one qubit, to entangle spins. And what you get directly from this precession here in this 2-qubit subspace is a called square root swap gate, which can be transformed into a C0 gate, so it's a universal gate for the purpose of quantum computing together with single qubit gates. And there was some demonstration, partial demonstration of such a gate from the group of Delft. So they have measured now, done the same thing with this spin selective readout on 2 qubits and on the 2 spins on the left and on the right. And in between, operate an exchange interaction between the two. These are the different readout traces. And they found that indeed there are exchange-like oscillations between these 2 spins. But one thing they could not quite do yet is demonstrate entanglement, because that would have been required in addition the manipulation of the individual spins in order to do measurements in all the possible bases. So that was not added to that particular experiment yet. Nevertheless, it shows that in principle it could be extended, and it's just a matter of, well, technology and complexity to add 2-qubit operations. Now, for the theoretical sake of completeness, but I think this is actually quite promising, and we are starting to think about doing this experimentally, you can also use an exchange-based 2-qubit gate for 2-electron spins. This is very similar to the exchange-based approach for the exchange-only qubits. So again, you have 4 spins, each encoding 1 qubit, and here if you, in the simplest case, have 1 interaction between the 2, this is enough to generate a C-phase gate. The basic idea is that if in this subspace of spin 2 and 3, so this is not a qubit subspace, it's kind of a virtual 2-spin subspace that's not part of our logical qubit space, but if you generate an identity here, so go once around the Bloch sphere, this will imprint a phase on these 2 states, whereas other qubits that have the other qubit states that have these spins on the inner one parallel or anti-parallel will not experience this phase. So this is why it gives something like a C phase gate, but being an identity here in the subspace, you do not leak into states that are not valid. If you were to do a real swap between them, you could, for example, go from, say, up, down. Say, if you do this one, if you swap the 2 inner ones, you could go to down, down, up, up. This would be leakage, it's no good, but if you do an identity, that's okay. So the nice thing about this approach is it's not overly complex, it's something like a 3-step sequence, 1 2-qubit gate and some single gates to basically rotate into the right basis. And since it only relies on exchange interaction, which already works pretty well for single qubits, it's not fundamentally more difficult than single qubit operation, except that there's more spins around. Now what has been demonstrated, or we have demonstrated, this is work that I started at Harvard and then other people finished it, is a 2-qubit gate based on the Kuhnau interaction. So if you look at the singlet and triplet states in the 2 qubits, they have slightly different charge distribution, because in the singlet, 1 electron starts to tunnel towards the other dot. If you now capacitively couple the 2 qubits, basically by placing right next to each other, they will see this interaction. One technical aspect we need in order to read this out is now extend this single shot readout to both qubits at the same time. We did that by frequency multiplexing, so there's now 2 different resonances for 2 tank circuits for each qubit. One has 2 readout channels and can read that out with a single amplifier chain. And furthermore, because when the qubits are sensitive to each other, they are also sensitive to charge noise, and in order to at least reduce the effect of slow charge noise, we did a simultaneous echo. So the experiment works like this. You initialize, say, an up-down state, let both qubits evolve, then simultaneously do a pi pulse around delta BZ, so that's the same procedure as for this charge echo, and then let them evolve again. And the overall effect is that because of this pi pulse, any slow fluctuations of external charge noise are eliminated, whereas the qubit coupling, since both qubits are inverted at the same time, is maintained, and this enables to entangle the two qubits. I'd like to mention here that we stabilize the nuclear field gradient in both qubits at the same time here, which shows that it's a reasonably robust technique that can really be used in practice and doesn't only work once. And then we've done a complete characterization of this gate using state tomography, well, not of the gate, but of the final state, using state tomography after the entangling operation. So state tomography means measuring or reconstructing a complete two-qubit density matrix by measuring all the single and two-qubit operators, so basically all the possible correlations between readout values on the left and the right qubit. And in ideally, for an entangled state, you would see lots of bars in the entangled or in the mixed or in the correlators, whereas each individual measurement on a single qubit would yield a completely mixed state because it's entangled with the other qubit. And roughly speaking, that's also what we obtain. And in particular, let's see, if we rotate the data back into a basis up to single qubit operations, we are imperfect. You indeed see strong correlations in the mixed channels and very weak results in the single qubit channels. The optimal result in the presence of decoherence would look like this. And what we find is that the overlap with a maximally entangled state, the closest maximally entangled bell-like state, is about 70%, which is large enough to imply entanglement between the two qubits. So this was and still is the first complete demonstration of a two-qubit gate on this characterization on spin qubits. And, well, what you can also look at is this bell state fidelity as a function of evolution time. What you see is, well, after the first maximum of entanglement, the two qubits become disentangled again because the evolution goes on, and then the second maximum doesn't quite make the threshold because of charge noise. So there's still, also the 70% here are still limited by charge noise in the environment. There is a concept for extending this from direct adjacency to a distance of about 10 microns, and the results say that if you put an antenna between the qubits, this could be extended to basically the same coupling strengths as we had right now, but now over 10 microns. And thus you should be able to reach the same gate fidelity in theory. But there's a couple of problems, I think. There's this charge noise, or this coupler could also act as a charge noise antenna. You would have control crosstalk, you do something to this qubit, this also sees it. More important, you have next to nearest neighbor coupling. If you couple this qubit again to another one, then suddenly you have coupling from here over to this neighbor. And all of these, I think, make this charge coupling not the optimal way to go. What seems more promising to me is exchange coupling and then maybe shuttling qubits around. But creating long-range coupling between individual spin qubits, I would say, is still one of the biggest challenges experimentally in the field. All right, so I think I will just skip here, and then so in the afternoon I'll also say a few things about how I imagine spin qubits can be scaled up to very large systems. My personal vision of this looks like this, that you have a fully integrated semiconductor, quantum processor, all operated in dilution refrigerators. But well, depending on time, maybe a little bit more on that this afternoon. So thanks for your attention. Well, I guess there will be some conversation over lunch or so. So feel free to ask more questions.
Thank you very much. There were quite a lot of questions during the break, but if there's a quick question now, you can still take
it. Exchange qubits, I asked you the question about the interaction J12 and J13.
Mm-hmm.
And you said that they are aligned. can we, is there any requirement to align, always align these qubits? Can we use like a star model here?
Let's go back to that device. Yeah, I would say there's no strict requirement, but it's hard enough to operate these devices or to realize these devices where you have coupling from one spin to the other. You need exchange, which means you need tunnel coupling, which means they need to be very close together. And it has taken the community to have some time to have tunnel coupling from one spin to two neighbors. If you now, in addition, want to have tunnel coupling to another one, that's pretty tough, and you know, you realize there's gates all over the place. Bringing in more control gates to tune these couplings doesn't seem like fun, especially on even less in a scalable setting. So I'm pretty happy that I only need two exchange couplings as an experimentalist.
Any other questions? No? Okay, so let us thank Hendrik again for this wonderful lecture, and so see you after lunch.